Tonight, we're going to talk to you here about something very specifically beyond where you have come at to this point, and looking in unto and into the realms of the things that Christ Jesus did and has called us to do. My wife was asking me this afternoon. She said, "Honey, have you ever been in a meeting where you saw someone's leg grow out?" I said, "Sweetheart, I've never been in a meeting where I saw anyone's leg grow out." She said, "Well, I saw a woman today," because it doesn't happen. It just hasn't happened. I'm talking about a limb cut off, just so that everybody understands very well what I'm talking about. I'm in the middle, okay, of what's going on in the church. I'm not talking about somebody sitting up in a chair and, you know what I'm saying, their leg grew a half inch and the other one grew an inch and so the other one had to grow another inch or whatever, you know. Are you with me? I'm not, you know what I'm saying? I'm talking about the exploits of God. I'm talking about sun and moon stand still stuff. I'm talking about moving on into something that's a bit more credible. You know what? Every time CNN came out to shoot whatever it was that was going on that we were saying as the church was miracle signs and wonders, they couldn't find enough evidence to broadcast it. And it wasn't because they didn't want to or they had some kind of spin. And no, it's because there wasn't enough evidence. And Father wants to create enough evidence. He wants to create enough evidence. And I said to my wife, I said, "No, I haven't seen anybody. I haven't seen any limbs grow out. You know, I've never seen anybody with a cut off arm and the arm grow out or cut off hand grow out. I've never seen anyone with a cut off finger and the finger grow out." Now, I have heard about a pastor. I have heard about it happening. And it was in the days of Mariah Woodworth Eder, a dear pastor, had his finger, he got it cut off when he was working, and he was contemporary to Mariah Woodworth Eder, and the docks, you know, it was rotten by the time he got it to the dock. It was already, you know, too far beyond being able to sew it back on and it be okay. So he said, "Go ahead, sew it back on there, it's going to be all right." And Doc said, "No, you can't do that. The thing is going to, you know, it's already rotting. It won't ever live. It's already decaying tissue. And it's going to cause sepsis to run up your arm. And you're going to get gangrene in your arm and your body. And you're going to die." He said, "Sew it on." Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so he was in a meeting one night. And he was preaching and ministering. And there was a guy in a wheelchair right in front of him. And he went to make a point. And his finger fell off, hit the guy in the wheelchair. The guy in the wheelchair suddenly trying to get the finger off him stood up and was completely made whole. And the pastor got a new finger, okay? The preacher got a new finger. So I haven't got to see it. I haven't got to see it. But I'm telling you right now, that came from a very credible source, an eyewitness who's still alive, and it was his daughter. His daughter's like 86 years old now. And that's a great one. Yeah. But the bottom line of it is the Lord has these signs and wonders and miracles for us all the time. We just are bogged down and stuck in our various different ideas and doctrines and models and thinking. And we're going to have to just be willing to set aside all of our ideas and all of our thinking and all the rest of the books, and we're going to have to start reading the Bible, and we're going to have to do exactly what the Bible says to do. Carlos Anacondia, one day, he was just a businessman, Roman Catholic, you know, didn't know much about God at all, and he had an encounter with the Lord Jesus. He gave his life. He came under Holy Ghost conviction. Simple, you know, everyday, ordinary, you know, kind of encounter with the Lord, came under Holy Ghost conviction, just like you and I did, responded to an altar call, went to the altar, opened, and then after that, opened up his Bible, read in the Bible that he was supposed to go and clothe the naked and feed the hungry and minister to those in prison and visit those in the hospital. And so he did it. And then before long, it wasn't just one or two people in the hospital handing out clothes and food out in the park. Before long, the crowds were 10,000, 50,000, 100,000. And South America was changed because one person said, opened up the Bible and said, "I'm just going to start doing what the Bible says to do." Yeah. And so I'm going to talk to you tonight in the school of the Spirit here about a childlike faith, about a simple obedience to God. Now listen, I'm going to tell you right now, if you're not over sin yet, you still want to do sin and you want to be a hypocrite, you know what? This doesn't even fit you. You know what I'm saying? just forget about it. You're not going to have any of this. You're just going to be running interference with, including in the name of Jesus. So if there's anybody like that in this place tonight or watching me on the web, you might as well just forget about it. Turn me off right now because this doesn't matter to you. This isn't even relevant to you. Okay? I'm talking to everybody in this place here tonight. You hungry for the things of God. You serious about God. You are so blessed that you are rescued out of the realms of death and brought into His life. You so desperate about living out a heavenly life. And you're willing to do whatever God says for you to do. He's then empowered us to be able to do it all through the acts of simple obedience. It's just that simple. You know what? God is going to have... Come up here, son. God is going to have him... a glorious church. He's going to have a glorious church. Hallelujah. Now, let me just tell you right now, God's going to have a glorious church without spot or wrinkle. And if that's what his passion is, that's what my passion is going to be. If he's not going to have leaven in the place, I'm not going to have leaven in the place either. Are you with me? I mean, we just need to get a zeal for these things. If we'll get a zeal for what God, if our heart becomes what God's hearts are set on, we're going to have those things that Father has been willing to supply to us. Hallelujah. Praise God. So I want you to open your Bible. Here's where I'm going to start. And I want to look in Acts chapter 2 in verse 38. And I want you to just look at the whole gospel plan almost in a verse of scripture. Okay? So Peter says, then Peter said unto them, repent, hallelujah, and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, or for the erasing, remitting, the complete doing away with sin. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Okay? So look at here. It's real simple. You repent. That means that God, look, and the repentance is God granting us the gift of repentance. He's given to us the ability to completely change, because this repent word, it literally is to change. It's more than just to turn and go 180 degrees. It means that you change. Everything about you is brand new. Okay, and hallelujah. And now you're so set up now that you can begin to receive everything that comes from God. Hallelujah. And listen, I've watched it over and again where people just get a little bit of anointing, you get a little bit more going on in their life that's above the average, and suddenly you've got revival. And then they get stuck in whatever it is that they were doing, and they don't move on. Father's looking for you and I to hook up with every expression of the new man, of the divine nature, of the new creation, and love it and want to tend to it and want to give ourselves completely over to that all day long. I mean, when you're doing that, how do you even have a possibility to go do something else that belongs to the realms of the demonic? My goodness gracious, we're supposed to be we're supposed to go out and reach souls, not damn them. You know what I'm saying? We're supposed to bring Holy Ghost conviction, not, you know, bring demonic influence. Hello. I mean, people, we got to have to go ahead and yield ourselves to the Holy Ghost. Come on, man, and stand up and not allow anything that is contrary to the ways of God to exist in our thinking to begin with. And we'll fight the battle there. And then to grab a hold of that which the Holy Ghost is doing and supplying to us to be able to walk out all the disposition of the glory of God. Hallelujah. So the Lord says, repent, be baptized. And he's talking to us about the baptism in water. I mean, Mark said, they that believe and are baptized, the same shall be saved. And you know, the Lord Jesus emphasized that we're going to have baptism this week, this weekend, between the services, between Sunday morning service and the Sunday evening service. Everybody you know that hasn't been baptized needs to get baptized. And everybody who's backslidden needs to get baptized again. You need to get baptized till you quit backsliding.
Amen.
That's the way I feel about it. Hallelujah. Amen. You backslide, get baptized again in Jesus' name. Let everybody see. Yeah, there he is, or there she is, right back in the water. Well, praise God. At least she's coming, or he's coming, trying to get himself, you know, put together and stop yielding to a demon spirit and start yielding to the Holy Ghost. See, demon spirits will force himself on you. And then ruin you and destroy you. God, the Holy Ghost, is waiting for you to yield, and he'll empower you, and nothing can stop you. I'm telling you right now. All I got to do is say, oh, rise, oh God. Rise, go, rise, oh Lord, and go before me, and let your enemies be scattered. Hallelujah. Woo. Hallelujah. We got a shield about us, huh? Hallelujah. He's our glory. He's the lifter of our head. And we got more than a shield. I'm baptized in the fire cloud of God's divine glory. I'm baptized inside of that which their eyes could not behold when he spoke on Mount Sinai in the midst of the fire. Hallelujah. I'm in the midst of that which set down upon the tabernacle in the wilderness. I'm standing in the midst of baptized in that same divine glory, and the one whose face was hidden away from all men to see is living inside of me. Hallelujah. And if you grab a hold of the glory of it, the gift of it, the privilege of it, I mean, you're like, why on earth would you want to eat out of your septic system?
That's right.
All you need is some wisdom and some revelation. I'm crying out to God. I'm saying, oh, God, show us things. We're going to call to you tonight. Show us things, oh, God, that we have not known. Show us great and mighty things that we've not known. Hallelujah. That's what God has for his people who seek him diligently. That's what God's got for his people who lay hold on him. And so I'm gonna help you tonight, because tonight, after we're finished with the meeting, if you've got a problem in your life with perpetual backsliding, if you've got a problem in your life with some kind of torment and affliction, that's a demonic power that we want to show you how to get that thing broken off of you, and we're going to have some people get around you and help you. If you've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues, or something seriously going wrong in your life, we're not going to pat you on the back and say you all right. We're going to say there's something seriously wrong with your life. Right. We're going to just bring it down for what it is, because God poured out his Holy Ghost upon all flesh.
Yeah.
And I mean, my goodness, if you aren't receiving what God has, you got some serious messed up thing we want to help you with. I'm going to get some people around you, pray for you, and talk to you till we get whatever's in the way out of the way so you can move forward with God. Hallelujah. And so, you know, really, I'm going to say this about baptism in water. You know, there's many times I've seen Hindus, I've seen Buddhists, I've seen Jews, I've seen just crazy heathens. They'll do everything. They'll repeat after you everything, but they won't go to the water and be baptized. Why? Because it sorts things out in their life. It's a consecration. It's a commitment. It's a going all the way with God. And that's why baptism in water baptism is a very important part of this. Because the Lord Jesus told us to go and baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, to participate with something that is supernatural, that's spiritual. It's like this table over here. This is the cross of Christ. This represents not only the cross of Christ, but the power of the resurrection. Because this is the means by which death and hell lost its power. And people come up to eat his flesh, to partake of his slaughter, and their heart's not right. I wouldn't want to be near you. I wouldn't stand around you any time of day. Every time I got near you, I'd say, stand at least 10 feet from me. You know, I'm not fellowshipping with somebody like that, man. I'll tell you right now, just get away. Go with the rest of the demons, man. Go carouse with the rest of hell. You know what I'm saying? I want nothing to do with that stuff. But when somebody's crying out for God to rescue them and save them, when they're serious, my goodness, we're the first ones. We're Johnny on the spot. What I'm talking to you tonight about is I really want to get you set up so that you understand how that you can be effective at reaching the lost, how you can be effective at shaking nations, you know? Right now, we're trying to catch up on our sleep because we're getting ready to go to, you know, we're getting ready to go to Norway. We're getting ready to go to India, two areas of India. And then to Kashmir Valley, and then to do the leadership conference in Zambia, Africa. And then we're going to come back, and then we're going to go to the pastor's conference in Cuba. And in between, we've got three major churches in the United States that we're going to go preach at. Okay, so we're just getting warmed up here. We're getting more effective at how to reach the lost and shake nations. Well, you know what? That all started in my life. It started in me. My life is just simply obeying God and doing what God told me to do, because I opened up the Bible, and here's what the Lord said to do. And I said, Father, I want this. I don't want the other things that everybody else is interested in. I want you. I discovered or experienced this overwhelming love of God. And I said, Lord, I want to live in this love all the time. And there I had some challenges about that. I didn't really understand, you know, how to yield myself always to the love, because, you know, you have things happen to upset you. People, you know, do things that are contrary to you, or, you know, persecute you or whatever, and, you know, messes everything up. And then I learned how to yield to God. I learned how to yield to him and have that love anytime I ask, anytime I was willing to just acknowledge him. That's why the Lord tells us that we're supposed to be baptized all the time. This is a loose translation, but he said, be baptized all the time. Be baptized in the Holy Ghost all the time. Huh? Or be filled with the Spirit. Because people ask me, what's the difference between being filled with the Spirit and being baptized in the Spirit? Nothing. There is no difference. Because the Lord said, Jesus said in Acts 1:5 and Acts 1:8, you'll be baptized. And in Acts 2:4, they were filled. So I know there's absolutely no difference between what it means to be baptized and be filled. So I recognize that God's command for me, what He wants for me, and what He wants for you, is that you find a place where you continually, or where you have an ongoing opportunity to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And that is the baptized in the Holy Ghost where you feel the joy, where you feel the love, where you feel the peace. Somebody said, do I need to feel anything when I pray? Yeah, you do. You do. Well, what if I don't? You didn't pray long enough. Yeah. Hallelujah. And you didn't pray right. Because the scripture tells us, build up ourselves, strengthen ourselves. Huh? To strengthen ourselves, build up ourselves. See, they went to cast out that boy out of the boy. They went to cast that devil out of that little boy. The father recognized that they didn't have the strength. They didn't have the strength. They had the dunamis. They didn't have the isku. They needed to be strengthened so they get cooperating with the Holy Ghost so that which they've been empowered with and given could flow out of them. They'd spent too much time arguing with the church leaders, arguing with, you know, the scribes, telling them what, you know, how they're supposed to do it and where they're going wrong, and you know, got to watch out for what their teacher's saying because he's really just a little bit overboard in zeal, huh? And then it starts working in their thinking, you know, and starts shutting down the flow of the Holy Ghost. We're going to have simple, childlike faith with God and be what He said we are. Just be what He says you are. Everybody comes, tells you, quit looking in the mirror of self. Get rid of the mirror of self. Quit allowing everybody to bring their mirror of comparisons, okay? Yeah. Break them. Yeah. Break them. Quit looking at that monster. look in the mirror of the Word and behold what? Behold the image. What image? I behold in the image of God. I'm beholding Jesus. I'm beholding God. Hallelujah. And then and there you're changed from glory to glory. See, you're going to have to be willing to cooperate with the Holy Ghost. You're going to have to be willing to prophesy over yourself. You're going to have to learn to obey spiritual laws. The spiritual laws of God that are in Christ Jesus, okay, has made us free from the law of sin and death. But you're going to have to obey the spiritual laws. You can't walk around sad and mopey and think that you're flowing in the Holy Ghost. You got to, when you cursed, you got to bless. Hallelujah. When you do well and suffer for it, you get corrected for it, and you take it patiently, and you say, yes, sir, please forgive me. I'm going to get this right. What the Lord said, my, that's exactly what I was looking for out of my people. You know, you got to learn how to do it God's way. You got to learn how to keep yourself in the love of God. You're going to have to learn how that there is a realm of peace that passes all understanding that the world can't take from you. And when that you see something going on that's disturbing that, you cry out to God, the Holy Ghost, and you say, Lord, let your peace overwhelm me now. I just yield myself to your peace. And that becomes the way that you relate and interact with the Lord. And He develops you and grows you and matures you in a relationship with Him so that we have that disposition of that He has purchased for us, and we walk in the abundant life that He has given to us, and as a result, we begin to shine as a light to a lost and dying world because we're different. And furthermore, He then, according to what Peter said in 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 11, then because we give all diligence to making our calling and election sure, because we're not going to allow compromise in our life, because we're not going to afford bad behavior, we're not going to allow anything but love, we're not going to allow anything but godliness, we're not going to allow anything but goodness, we're not going to allow anything but kindness. He says, then I will open up a door for you. I will minister to you ability and entrance. This is what I'm talking to you about tonight. I will show you how to enter in to the realms of the kingdom. Are you listening to me?
Yeah. Amen.
Listen, people sit around acting like it's God's fault. It's not God's fault. He didn't put a frown on your face.
That's right.
It's not His fault.
That's right.
He didn't put a bad attitude in your spirit.
That's right.
He didn't do any of that.
That's right.
He made provision so you didn't have to have any of that. Hallelujah. Man, you spend time wanting the things of God in your life, and you know what's going to happen? You won't have any time for the things of the demonic. In fact, the things of the demonic will be death to you. It will be a torture and a torment to you. You live in peace, and you're not going to be able to handle condemnation. Because that's the opposite of peace. The opposite of peace is not war. The opposite of peace is condemnation. And condemnation is the worst thing because that's in conflict with God. Are you listening to me? That's why the Lord says peace to those that are near and peace to those that are far away. He's saying, therefore, now there's no condemnation. Come on in here. Come on in over here into the realm of fellowship. Father has invited us to come into a fellowship and a communion with him where we're sitting down and we're partaking of his life and of his goodness, which that's what the table is all about. This life and power of God that lives in us. It's just a testimony that the very life and power of God lives in me. The life of the flesh is in the blood. And there, all that life was poured out to me and made available to me at Calvary's cross. And therefore, I find in that not only divine health. Do you find divine health in the cross? Yeah, because he said, by his stripes we were healed. That's divine health. I don't have to get sick and get healed. I get to be healthy and not get sick.
Amen.
I get to be healed before I'm sick. Yes. Amen. Right. So, and there's also there in the cross, there is divine provision and there is divine perfection. Everything that we have need of, why would we leave? Why would we go away from that which the Holy Ghost has come to minister to us? And so the Lord tells us, here in this one verse of scripture, he encapsulates the whole thing. He says, repent, be baptized, and you shall receive, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins. And of course, that is all within the framework of calling upon the name of the Lord. It's not baptism in water for remission of sins. We know how the only one way sins can be washed away, and that is by the blood of Jesus Christ. But he's just giving us, encapsulating for us the whole of the gospel, to repent and to do what God's told us to do. To repent, those that believe and are baptized, the same shall be saved. Praise God. Amen. Because it's part of the covenant. And then we receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And I want to just make a connection here in Acts 10, quickly, Acts 10 and verse 45. And here's Peter. And as Peter was speaking these words to Cornelius' house, the Holy Ghost fell on them, which heard the word. And they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. And so I'm showing you a bridge here, okay? Because if you don't listen to the bridge, somebody's going to ask you a question, and you won't be able to give them an answer because you weren't listening, okay? And the gift of the Holy Ghost is equivalent to the outpouring of the gift of the Holy Ghost that we see on the day of Pentecost, which should have already been clear by context in Acts chapter 2. But now Acts 10:45 makes it all the more clear, because verse 46, when they received the gift of the Holy Ghost, what happened? They all began to speak with other tongues. Do you see that? The gift of the Holy Ghost isn't just, I mean, you look at the precedents that are set at Cornelius' house. These people are getting these, you know, and once again, here we got folks that have not been born again yet. The word of God's now come to them. And you know, all they did was sit there and listen to the word of God go forth. And in their hearts were right with God. That's what they wanted. And it was almost that they didn't even have an opportunity to even say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. He came before they even got a chance to ask. They were ready, and they were speaking with other tongues before they were saying anything. And they ain't even been baptized with water yet. They haven't done all the things that we figure we've got to take people through, that we do have to take people through. Because it can happen, there's no limiting God. What we want at the end of the analysis is we want the fruit and the witness of the Holy Ghost. If the fruit and the witness of the Holy Ghost is not there, then whatever you did needs to be done again. All right, we need to figure out what's wrong, okay? I mean, they didn't even have to, repeat after me prayer once again or be baptized in water. They had the evidence right there. They began to speak with other tongues. That was proof enough for all those that were in the company of Peter. But there's a lot of people come to church. They do all the repeat after me. They come up to the altar. They do all the various things. They go water baptism, and they still don't have the witness that they've been born again. And so listen, people, you and I are going to have to be willing to work with people and minister to people till they get a breakthrough. Until the reality of what God has said becomes witnessed in their life, and quit telling people they're saved when you don't know whether they are or not. Because I'm telling you right now, we've got a great witness right here in Acts chapter 10. Peter didn't even know it was available for them. And the guys that were with them, they didn't even know, hardly know why they were there. Just the Lord said, go with the guys that are down there waiting for you, asking no questions, doubting nothing. And he gets there and he says, well, we don't really know why we're here other than the fact that the Lord appeared to me, told me to come. And so he's like standing there stunned. And then Cornelius then picks it up from there and goes, well, an angel of the Lord told me to send for you and that you were going to tell us everything about the gospel of life. Yeah. Peter's like, what? Well, here we go. Well, let me tell you about Jesus. I'm going to tell you about... And he begins to... He just begins to lay out the basic message of salvation, how that Jesus was anointed of God, anointed of the Holy Ghost, anointed with the Holy Ghost and power, and who went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil, because God was with him, and lays out just the real basic message of salvation. The Holy Ghost falls upon them. Hallelujah. Now, I want you to understand that what I'm showing you here is this. Fundamentally, this idea that the Holy Ghost is only given to those who are going to be going around as apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers is absolutely so far from reality, and that the Holy Ghost just has, or just that the Holy Ghost or the empowerment of the Holy Ghost is just all about one dimension of the expressions of the Holy Ghost, whether it would be, and most people put it in the category of the power gifts, where miracles and word of knowledge and gifts of healing. No, the empowerment of the Holy Ghost is about every dimension of the life of God being expressed through our lives. Hallelujah. Because our spirit is hooked up with His Holy Spirit so that we can understand how to begin to move in those things that Jesus moved in within the realms of the nature of God. He looked upon the people and He didn't see a bunch of folks that were deadheads and didn't get it and slow learners and just can't, you know, seem to get a hold of God. He saw something different by the Spirit. He was moved with compassion. You know, you listen to me. Until we begin to look at people and begin to move with compassion, we're not going to be very effective at ministering to them. As long as we're in some kind of a works program, have to program, statistics program, ain't no flow of God, the Holy Ghost ever going to be there because our heart's not right. We got to get a childlike heart, get hooked up with the relationship that God has provided for us by the power of His indwelling glory in our lives, and then we're going to be effective. Hallelujah. At doing the work of the ministry. I mean, God has given us great authority, but that authority only works by the Holy Ghost. Father's given us great authority, but you and I are going to have to learn how to, we got to understand that the models that exist today in the church are wrong models, where people are just as much interested in yielding to the Holy Ghost as they are in yielding to demon spirits. Just whatever's good for the time. Okay, I feel like doing some lust now. I feel like doing some immorality now. I feel like doing some hate now. Or whatever else. Whatever that the environment is creating. And people get, I feel like doing sadness now. Environment's creating sadness. People wake up with a little bit of a hormonal problem and they've taken away by the hormones. Hormones far greater in power than the Holy Ghost. Are you listening to me? Yes. They wake up a little bit low on serotonin because your sleep's a little bit, you know, deficited. And now serotonin is far greater in power than the Holy Ghost. God's got to take a backseat to hormones, serotonin. What else? Huh? The weather, how people are treating you, your disposition. Some little teeny thought that went through your head that was not even, I mean, real. It was an imagination. Are you listening to me? Now, Holy Ghost, totally, just completely gone. He's gone. God's gone. God don't even exist anymore. He's so unreachable. He's so beyond reaching Him that it will take, you know, 30, 40 days of fasting and praying or something. I mean, He's so far beyond even that. That's what happens. People get locked down in this thing because they don't understand the beauty and the splendor of the availability of the Holy Ghost. They've yielded their members and their thinking realm too long to things that are inspirations of men and of devils. Listen, I'm telling you right now, the Lord Jesus said, if you're trying to seek men's approval, you're unrighteous. You're out of the picture. You can't even believe. People are walking around compromised. They got things going on in their life constantly. They got to have men's approval. You got to have men's approval. You get it. You can't flow, man. You can't move with God. Father wants us to seek only one approval. I only need the approval of one. Hallelujah. And that's I seek only His honor. That's the word that is used, but it's also a synonym for approval there in John chapter 5. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Now, people, you've got to understand, if these things become valuable to you, if you recognize that you're not living the full landscape of the abundant life, and God wants you to, and you're going to have to contend for the faith that was once delivered unto the saints. We're not living the full expression of rivers of living water pouring out of us. It's not that God hasn't made it available. It's not that it's not ours to have. It's just you're going to have to want it more than what you do. Because I'm going to tell you right now, you've got to play big time make-believe to say that you are living in a place where the rivers of where God's glory, His nature and His presence and His power is being expressed through you like unlimited flow of rivers. I mean, I think it would be amazing to have a fire hose amount. Or maybe even a garden hose, a continual garden hose of flow of the power of God. Well, maybe you have that. Well, praise God, huh? And I pray that you do. I pray that you have a fire hose. I pray that you have a creek size flow. I pray that you really do have in every way rivers of expression of God's glory going on more than 1 second out of 24 hours. Or more than 1 minute out of 24 hours. Huh? Because it's available. It's available, but we've got to want this more than anything else because it's so sacred. It's free, but it's so sacred. It's free, it's a gift, but it's so sacred. God's given this wonderful life to us, but we've got to learn how to yield to Him. It's got to be more important to us than anything else. It's got to be more important to us than all the menu that Satan has there in the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life that people sit there and make a choice of what they want. Hello. In the name of Jesus. Look, the propo te peti da bofa te deti ki ite supa, limbandolo pokera sipa, helemosipo romai, helps manamanga shikan in ite, make a transition. Hallelujah. From whatever it is that I'm in to whatever it is that God's purpose for me to live in at that very moment. So, I mean, when you think about this wonderful privilege that we have in terms of impacting the lost, do you want to reach the lost? If you do, you're going to have to learn how to flow in the Holy Ghost. Do you want to do greater miracles than what you're doing? If you do, you're going to have to learn how to flow in the Holy Ghost in a deeper realm. Do you want to be more effective in the call of God upon your life? Because it's available to all of us. And I think that we focus more on our actions and our deeds within the respect of the actions and the deeds and the exploits of God than we do on the relationship with Him. And the relationship with Him is always going to be in love. You're not going to have a relationship with God hating.
That's right.
And does this come as a shock to anyone? You're not going to have a relationship with God sad. He only can interact with Him in joy because He don't do sad. You have to go do sad all by yourself. Go stick your nose in the corner. All by yourself. You got to do sad all by yourself. God don't do condemnation. He doesn't do any condemnation. You and I choose, and think about how many times people are unwilling to listen to the teacher. God doesn't do intimidation. He doesn't do fear. He doesn't do control. He doesn't do depression. Oh, the Lord's walking through me with my depression. No, He's not. He's not walking through you with no depression. He's calling you to come on up. Hallelujah. Amen. Into rejoicing. Hallelujah. And thanksgiving. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. God sent us to deliver people from sin and sickness, and they're Siamese twins from hell. They are. They're Siamese twins from hell. It was all my sickness is from the Lord. He don't do sickness.
Nope.
He don't do disease. He does life.
Yes, he does.
He does goodness. Yeah. Yeah, you're walking in badness. James says, he tells us, James tells us in chapter 2, of course, Paul said the same thing, really, in Romans chapter 12. He said, you can't have sweet and bitter water coming out of the same fountain. You're defying the laws. You've got to learn how to get enough of a walk of relationship with God to shut up when it comes to saying wrong and bad things. Are you listening to me? Cursing, talking bad about people, running people down. You know, all it is when I hear people running somebody down, they just got to hurt. You need to be delivered. I'm going to run that devil off. Huh? I want you to quit communing with that devil, communing with that demon spirit.
That's right.
It's going to create greater problems in you.
Amen.
Yeah. Yes. Jesus put it like this. He said, you don't get good fruit off of an evil tree.
That's right.
And you don't go to an evil tree to get good fruit.
That's right.
The tree is evil and its fruit's evil, or the tree is good and its fruit's good. I'm going to tell you right now, God's made us a good tree to produce good fruit and no evil fruit allowed. He's made us a sweet, pure fountain flowing with His presence and His nature and His ways, and no bitter water allowed. But people have given themselves over to yielding to evil spirits. It's not just adultery and pornography and fornication and immorality. It's also strife and variance and slanders and murmurings and unthankfulness. And it shuts us down. We can't be the revivalists that God wants us to be. We can't be the miracle workers that Jesus purposed us to be, who went to all the towns and all the villages, healing all the sick and all the diseased that were in them, and casting out every unclean spirit. And that's what He sent His people to go and do. And you can't cast out unclean spirits when you're under the influence of one. You're going to end up, you know, being thrown into the ditch. Well, God's going to protect you. He's not going to let the devil jump on you and kill you just because you're stupid. Because you don't get it. Stupid, ignorant, right? Foolish, right? Because, no, this is what the Lord says. He said in Ephesians chapter 5, He said, do not be a moron. That's what He said. He said, and I know King James diluted it. He said, don't be unwise. But it's the word, the Greek word is marul, from an Arabic word, moron, which we translate fool. Don't be foolish, but be wise. And this, when you're wise, what are you going to do? You're going to get filled with the Holy Ghost. You know, lay there at night and think of every stupid thing you ever did and ever said, and regret upon regret. You listening to me?
Yeah.
Why do that? Why don't you get up and just walk around praising God? God, I stop out of that until you break through. Until the last about a neresica mostara won't stop. You know what I'm going to see today? You know how you know that you are flowing? You know how you get a gauge? There's a gauge. There's a Holy Ghost gauge. It's very difficult for you to stop. It's very difficult for you to stop speaking out of the realms of the heavenly. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God, the Holy Ghost came to train us. He come train our mouth. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He come train the words coming out of our mouth. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He come to train us to speak without thinking. Praise God.
Amen.
Everybody's trying to train each other to speak, to think before they speak. Now He come train us to speak without thinking. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Speak right out of the innermost being by the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Amen. Ta-ta-da mosa. I can tell some of you have not prayed through today. I tell. You know, dear, sweet, Miss Wesley, she had 19 kids. I believe like Charles was like the 18th or something like that. John was right up there, right on the bottom end too. Huh? And one day she came out and she hollered at the kids. And then she went back in the room. She was back in the room for a while. And Charles said she came back out and asked, repented to all the kids, said, please forgive me. Your mom didn't stand in the presence of the Lord before she came out in your presence. So you have to see an honorary side. Can you imagine if the church should actually repent and turn back to God, what it would look like? Could you imagine what if we started prioritizing God in our life and we didn't just do our little lay me down to sleep prayers? Huh? Oh, Lord, thank you for the potatoes and thank you for the eggs. And oh, God, bless Uncle Sam and Aunt Sally. And it's just a dry, dead nothing. Human Pavlon. Worse than that. What if we just wait on the Lord till we get overwhelmed with the Holy Ghost? Hallelujah. What if getting beautified by the Spirit of the Lord was more important than putting the makeup on? What if it was more important getting Halamon Jekesh? You would, I tell you right now, I don't care what's wrong with you. You wouldn't have whatever's wrong with you inside of a month. You started living like this, you would. I doubt you would have it with 24 hours. You would have your problems would last. I doubt with such a commitment. Because Father knows the heart. He's trying the heart. And as soon as the heart gets right, as soon as he sees within us a complete abandonment, we're going to have everything he's purposed for us to have. Right there.
That's right.
Hallelujah. And that really is just simply, come on, people. You just got to step out and start obeying God. If you're not hungry for the Holy Ghost tonight, to what I just read for you, then there is something seriously wrong with what you understand about Jesus Christ and the kingdom of God. Because this is what Jesus Christ is all about. He's the baptizer in the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
And if I couldn't receive that which Jesus is ministering, I'm under some kind of demonic stronghold. That's all there is to it. It may be a demonic stronghold of religion, because it's a demonic stronghold. Belief system. Ideas. It may be a demonic stronghold of hurt and offense. It's neither less, nonetheless. It may be a demonic stronghold of insincerity. It may be a demonic stronghold of where you're not willing to surrender all to God. But it's something like that. And we're going to break that thing off of you. And I'm telling you right now, if I was in that condition, I'd already run up to the front and be down here on the floor. Crying out to God, oh God, change me. Because if you're not hungry and thirsty for righteousness, you don't have the Spirit of the Son. You've not been born again. I'm telling you, just straight up. You might have been born into religion. Huh? You might have been born into religionity. But you're not born into the Spirit. Not by what God says in His Word. Born again based upon what men say in their philosophy and their ideology, but you need to read the Bible as a child in simplicity, hallelujah, and take it up. What am I talking about? I'm talking about you and I getting hooked up with the Holy Ghost to begin to do what God has told us to do, to be the people that God has ordained us to be, both in our relationship with Him and the purity of relationship that He's made us to have, to where that we're holy and acceptable unto Him, where we can come into the holies of holies with all boldness, with all confidence, where we're living out our lives in lowliness and meekness. This is where this is the attitude and disposition by which God is able to teach us. Where it's a disposition by which we're able to learn of Him. Jesus said, come and learn of me. I'm meek and lowly. Hallelujah. You don't have rest in yourself. You don't have rest. You haven't found the rest. It's all in this dimension. And so we're calling you to get really aggressive and desperate about the men before us and the women before us and the generations gone by. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ruthiana sent me a little bit of an example of what she preached last night, you know, and I was just so blessed because she sounded just like D.L. Moody. Sounded just like Booth. Huh? Sounded just like the preachers of old. That say you cannot come up here for Jesus unless you're willing to say no to every sin and every ungodliness. Unless you're willing to die and no longer live, you have no right to approach into this place called the altar of salvation. People just today it's different. People just kind of, you know, just try to, you know, build their statistics and talk people into coming, and you don't have to give up nothing. That ain't the Bible. You know, the eunuch said to Philip, what hinders me from being baptized? He says, nothing so long as you believe with all your heart. He examined him. Hallelujah. John examined people. Jesus examined people. He said, you got to bring forth fruit, meat, or evidence of repentance. This is about repenting. It's about forsaking your life. It's about being crucified with Christ. It's not about hanging on to your own life and doing your own will. People, there's a, you know, I've heard preachers say it all my life. There's a huge population of the church that will wake up in hell and they think they're on the way to heaven. Well, I'm going to make sure that everybody knows the difference, that they get to get around me. They're going to understand that they've got a witness and they've got evidence in the Bible. All they had to do was open the Bible and they could have read. They could have looked at their life and seen that the fruits of Jesus Christ was not there. And they weren't serious enough to get right with God and repent and break through to what Father has freely given. Because of insincerity in the heart. You listening to me? This is, I'm just trying to help you understand how to move with God the Holy Ghost. We don't get God the Holy Ghost results because we don't move with God the Holy Ghost. We got to start moving with Him. How do we move with Him? Do what He says and describes in His Word. How does God feel about things? How is it that He does it? When He says things, how does He say them? What is His disposition? What kind of emotions and passions does He want in our lives? He lists them all out for us again and again and again. So when I consider, when I think about the gift of the baptism of the Holy Ghost, the gift of the Holy Ghost, which is equivalent to the baptism in the Holy Ghost, as I've set precedence for you. Do I need to go over that? Does everybody get that? Does everybody get that? That this is the promise of the Father. That this is what Jesus was describing in John chapter 14 when He said, I'm going to send you another comforter. Huh? He's going to be with you and in you. In that day you will know the Father's in me and that I'm in you and that you're in me. That this you'll know that authority. You'll know that oneness. He gives to us a privilege now with an unlimited divine glory in our life so that we can do and give ourselves to the school of the Spirit in right over here in 2 Peter chapter 1. And I want you to look at it. I want you to become serious students of the Holy Spirit. It takes basically 11 sentences for us, really less than that. It really only takes about 8 sentences for us to know how to step into all the fullness of divine power and move with God in all the dimensions of His glory. Think about it. And I'm going to read this to you. I want you to understand the school of the Spirit. God wants us, John said, that He wants us to know and believe the love that God has for us. Amen. God is love. Now, can you hear that? Do you hear me?
Yeah.
Lift your hand if you cannot hear me. Okay. Are you listening?
Yes.
That's your problem. Most people's problem. They're meditating on how God doesn't love them. Or they're questioning of whether He does love them. And they're all sorted out because of all their relationships that got sideways. And it's all messed up because the way you're treating people around you is the way you treat God. That's what He said. And you'll treat people a lot better, hallelujah, when you start treating God right. And you'll start treating God right when you start receiving what He's freely given. To know and believe the love that God has for you. Do you know that you got to fight a big battle there? Do you know you got to fight a bunch of condemnation? You know you got to fight a bunch of accusation? You know you got to fight a bunch of slander? You know you got to fight a bunch of demon spirits? You know you got to fight a bunch of people's opinions? But you've received a gift of the Holy Ghost. You're going to do just good. You're going to do just fine. And you receive a gift of the Holy Ghost where you got a provision that is unlimited. I mean, you don't just have a measure. You don't have a cup full for the day. God gave you a cup full for the day. He didn't give you no cup full for the day. He didn't give you a gallon for the day. He didn't give you 10,000 gallons for the day. Use sparingly, only when needed. He gave us an unlimited provision of divine power and glory. And people sit around acting like that somehow God can't touch them. No, you haven't touched Him. Listen to me. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Raise your hand if you can't hear me. And when you understand that, you take that and you superimpose that. Knowing, believing the love that God has for us. God is love. He that dwells in love dwells in God. Herein is our love made perfect. You superimpose that now upon Ephesians chapter 3 verse 19. To know the love of Christ. That's the love of Christ. To know and believe the love that God has for us. That's the love of Christ. Knowing the love of Christ, you step over into the fullness of God. And how is it that we're able to do it? Because the power of God's at work on the inside of us, providing exceedingly abundantly above all that we can think or ask. But we've got to be, it's our will. We can sit there and be upset. We can sit there and be hurt. We can sit there and be offended. We can sit there and be confused. We can be, sit there and be belittled, overwhelmed, discouraged, disappointed, caught away with other things. And really, one of the things, one of the reasons that we do not move into the effectiveness that Christ Jesus purchased us to have, that the Holy Ghost has provided us to have, is once again, cares this life, deceitfulness of riches, pleasure of this world. It chokes this new life that God has given to us so that we don't bring forth fruit into perfection. So every once in a while we get a miracle or two. Every once in a while somebody listens to us about Jesus and somebody comes under Holy Ghost conviction. And then we act like we're going to blame it on God. Act like we got to have some kind of revival. Got to have some kind of move. No, we got to have some kind of obedience. We're going to have some change of our attitude about how precious this is and whether or not we're going to be in the school of the Spirit and whether or not we're going to pay attention to the Holy Ghost and what He's saying, because what He's doing, what He's saying is already written out for us. Here's the manual, and God the Holy Ghost brings life to it. He says, here's what I'm going to do, now let me do it. Can you hear me? He said, here's what I'm going to do, now let me do it. Yield to me and let me do it. Here's what I'm going to do, now let me do it. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Somebody said, I just don't have enough. Well, yeah, you do. If you've been, if you received the gift of the Holy Ghost, you've got more than enough. It's a more than enough is abundantly. That's a word that means more than enough. Superly abundantly. More than you can think or ask according to the power of God that's work, according to the power that is at work on the inside of you. Hallelujah. So he says to us, he said in verse 3, by his divine power, according to his divine power, he gave us everything we need that pertains to his life and his godliness. It's because we're talking about his life here. We're talking about abundant life, the life of God, the life of the Holy Ghost. Why do you live your own life? Well, stupid. Right. Come on. At some point, we're going, wait a minute, God, look at this glorious life. I mean, I look at Elijah and go, wow, that is amazing. I look at Moses standing on the mountain and you know, in Exodus 34, whoa, Daniel in his interactions with Father, Jesus in there at the Mount of Transfiguration, and the Lord saying, come on in. But this has got to be bigger to you and more important to you than anything else. And you're going to have to, you're going to be challenged constantly because all those other things that are interesting to you and choices are going to come there. And some people get stuck for 10, 15 years trying to make the decision. Well, this really looks good. Should I want to, but I'm not supposed to have this. But wow, it really looks good. Father, is it okay if I have this? And we spend 10 years doing that to finally go, oh yeah, I'm not supposed to have that. Why don't we just do it in the first second? Why are we on the, God gave us the expedited program, not the delayed program. Listen to me. He gave us everything that pertains to life and godliness because he wants us to function in his glory and in his purity. His glory and his virtue. What is his glory? He turned the water into wine, showed forth his glory. What is his glory? He walked upon the water. What is his glory? His glory is the demonstration of his exploit, his power. Hallelujah. His glory is seen in his lowliness and meekness as much as his glory is seen in commanding the wind and the waves. Amen. And he gave us his glory. How? He gave us his life. What is that? The new creation, the divine nature. And see, we look here, we see we've escaped the corruption that is in the world. Because why? We got the what? An old new nature. A new old nature. Huh? We got an old trying to become a new. We got a new kind of, you know, We're like a caterpillar. A caterpillar, give me a break. We like Jesus over here. Amen. A caterpillar, and we're divesting ourselves of our shell. We're going to pop out like a butterfly. Nonsense. Nonsense. We've been given the divine nature. We've already popped out. Praise God. Hallelujah. 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 And it's done. It's settled. It's settled. I've escaped the corruptions in the world through lust. Satan has no hold on me. He has no power over me. I have authority over everything that he does. I don't want any of his stinking stuff. I renounce it. I renounce the hidden thing. I don't want any of that thing, that former conversation. I have no fellowship with it. I rebuke it. I know King James diluted that word and tried to say reprove it. I rebuke it. That means you holler at it with an intense voice.
Yes.
And tell it you don't like it.
That's right.
Get away.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'd love to see God's people start screaming out, get away. Hallelujah. No wonder, well, I was pretty radical when I was young. And when I was younger, I was pretty radical. And I'd be out going to the beach, you know, and there'd be some girl come by and she didn't want to dress. I said, hey, listen to me. You get some clothes on. I'll have a towel. Get some clothes. Get out. Get. I'm trying to go surfing. I wanted to make sure I humiliated them as much as I possibly could. Because they're looking, especially if they're trying to look at me. He's trying to scope on me here, you know. Get some clothes on! And I had some choice words. That's how I evangelized women who were not properly dressed. Should never forget it. They would never forget it. Are you listening to me? That is so deplorable. That is so wretched. How can you possibly be in public like that? You know, whatever else was coming to me by the Holy Ghost at the moment. I'll tell you, I let it rip. They never forgot that. I guarantee you. Very good evangelism. God's people need to scream out against iniquity. We need to lift up our voice. The devil's lifting up his voice against us. I'll just have a shouting match. I guarantee you I can outshout the devil any day. I guarantee you, we need to start being who we are in public.
Yeah.
Amen. Huh? We need to stop. Not allow, people start cussing and all this other stuff. Get in the elevator. People start cussing. Just go. Look at them.
Amen.
Jesus.
Amen.
I guarantee you, they're going to start looking for the exit. Come on, don't stand there in silence. Do something.
Yeah.
Do something. Don't be quiet. And don't say, oh, please don't cuss around me. No, people need to be confronted. What you're doing is demonic. Hallelujah. We need to have some Holy Ghost conviction. God the Holy Ghost did not come as a defense attorney. He's a prosecuting attorney. He came to prosecute sin. He came to prove that sin is exceedingly sinful and evil, and it has an eternal judgment upon it. And we don't want to do what God the Holy Ghost is doing. We want to come up with something different. We want to dilute it, water it down, make it humanly acceptable. I'm going to get radical again. I just decided I'm going back to radical.
Amen.
Hallelujah. 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 Just go back to radical. And the Lord says, and now that because we've been given the gift of the Holy Ghost, because we've been given the new creation, we've been given the gift of the Holy Ghost, He tells us then, here's what He's focused on. This is what God the Holy Ghost is focused on. He says, give all diligence. That means a continual pursuit for excellence to add to your faith purity. Purity. Pure thoughts, pure behavior, pure actions, pure dress. Oh, they go, oh no, now he's preaching from the clothesline. Absolutely. There needs to be a revival of somebody going to preach from the clothesline. Amen. Oh, we used to be holiness too. We got delivered. No, you got imprisoned. Dear people, come on. I'm talking about the glorious liberty of the sons of God. I'm talking about living the abundant life. I'm talking about he that the Son sets free is really, truly free. Free from all the mess and all the stuff, all the disease and all the pain, all the sin and all the iniquity, all the condemnation, all the separation, all the mediocrity and nothingness, the vanity. Hallelujah. I'm going to live over here and sit at the table of the kingdom, at the table of the king, along with all the mighty. And God's inviting every single person to do it. And He says, look, get in the school of the Spirit. This is what the Holy Ghost has come to lead us and guide us to do. This is what He's come to teach us. He's come to take everything that belongs to the Father, and He wants to show us how to do it, because every display of the miracle power of God actually is hooked up with and flows out of God's love and God's faith and the other dimensions of His fruit, of His compassion, of His mercy, of His forgiveness. Are you listening to me? You're not going to have any gifts of the Spirit flowing through you without love and faith. You're not going to have it. You're not going to have a display of the power of God going forth through your life unless you're standing over in a realm of divine peace. You're not going to have it. You're not going to have it. It's going to be, every dimension of the display of the power of God is hooked up with the dimensions of His nature. Hallelujah. And of His disposition. And He tells me, give all diligence. In other words, I'm going to be watchman over myself. I'm going to make sure that I'm not going to get into some kind of impure thought, impure thinking. I'm not going to get into some kind of doubt and unbelief. I'm not going to sit there and think about how negative it is. And it happens because I don't know why Satan is allowed to do what he does, but he is allowed by God to tempt us and influence us to some degree as the prince in the power of the air. But Father has always given us the ability to say no to it, because through the process, Father will strengthen us if we'll cooperate with Him. I've woken up, there's times I go to sleep feeling just fine, praising God, reading the Word, and I wake up and feel like, you know, just having this thought like, just thoughts like, you know, people aren't going to listen, or somebody's talking bad about me, or, you know, just something just negative. What are you going to do? Start walking around in that? And I know that you do too, because we just a bunch of lookalikes and acolytes. No, you got to get a hold of your thoughts, and you got to say, wait a minute, that's doubt and unbelief. We're not going to have the money to take care of the finances and the bills, and they're not going to be, you know, all the negative stuff. Whatever, right? Are you with me? Of course you are. And maybe you let the thing run ruin on you so much you forgot all, you didn't even notice it anymore. You just live like that. I mean, you know, come on. You got to get quick with this, because you committed to the school of the Holy Ghost, and you rise up and you go, you foul spirit of hell, you lying thing. Father, I thank you for strengthening me right now. Holy Ghost. Thank you, Lord Jesus, to go to praise Him and worshiping Him. Hallelujah. Go ahead. That is a perfect time. That is one of those moments that you know for sure you need to be baptized. Are you with me? This is just extra. I need baptism right now. Now, don't be foolish. Don't be a moron. Don't be unwise. But be wise. Huh? Knowing what is the will of God. Hallelujah. Amen. This is how you redeem the time, for the day is evil. Don't be drunk with wine because you feel depressed. You need a little help. But be filled with the Holy Ghost. And begin to speak to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Sing and make a melody in your heart to God. Hallelujah. This is what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to pray with all prayer and supplication. That's urgent prayer. Supplication means urgent prayer or pleading prayer. Hallelujah. An urgent pleading prayer with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. Watching thereunto with thanksgiving. Watching for what? Watching that you don't allow things that are from the realms of the demonic to influence you. Why? Because we want to become more effective at reaching the lost. We want to see a turning back to God, a moving of the things of the Spirit of God. That's a revival of that which God has given. We want to see the limbs grow out. God has given us the power to go raise the dead. And there's some of you, the next 30 days, when I say how many of you prayed for somebody that is dead, you go raise your hands in here. Amen. Because some of you guys got to go tomorrow to raise the dead. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. They're taking some food because the Lord said give her some food as soon as she got up, and they're taking a change of clothes and get out of the burial garment. Come on, man. The look of horror strikes the face. Yeah, that's the problem over here. Too much doubt and unbelief. We're supposed to be over in the realm of faith. And you know, look at how faith is. See how faith is presented there? Look how faith is presented there. Faith is presented there that I've got all I need. That's what it's presented. By His divine power, boy, that's a lot, has given me everything that I need that pertains to life and godliness, because He's called me to glory and virtue. All this thing is settled because I got the divine nature, and Satan has no more power over me. I've escaped the corruption of the world through lust. That's the faith. See how the faith is now framed up right there in verses 3 and 4? Do you see that? Yes. Now I can give myself to purity because God wants it. Yes. He wants a pure flow. Huh? Nobody wants to drink some contaminated, polluted water. Once again, like I opened up, I haven't had people ask me lately, what is the worst water to drink? They're asking me, what's the best water to drink? Yeah. You want pure water. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm getting ready to go drink the best water out at the ranch here leaving on Monday, early Monday morning. That's good water. Praise God for that. But I got good water right here. I got good water by the Holy Ghost. And I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this. There's so many people don't even know how to. They can't even name the nine fruits. There's more than nine fruits of the Spirit. Then there's more than just nine that is given in Galatians chapter 5. But they don't even know how to name them. That's how much they give all diligence to it. Can't even name what you focused on passionately pursuing. Give me a break. Get real in the school of the Spirit. Come on, give me a break. If you don't have any more memory than that, then we'll get you healed. We'll get you healed. There's 26 fruits of the Spirit. Come on, man. People act like, well, I don't feel like forgiveness today. You give me a break, man. You just walked away from God. You just said, Holy Ghost, get away from me. I'm not doing what you're wanting to do. I want to be bitter today. I want to be evil fruit today. No. Come on, people. Let's quit letting the enemy run interference with this wonderful divine program. Understand, here is what he's doing. This is the list. Look at it. Don't allow doubt and unbelief to operate. Get over in the realm of faith and I'm trying, but it just, I'm overwhelmed with doubt and unbelief. Pray in the Holy Ghost till faith comes. Build up yourself in your most holy faith. Pray. God gave us an answer for every problem.
Yes.
He's given us all that we have need of. Yes. Get out yourself.
Yes.
And get into him.
Amen.
And I wish that was the only problem. Because people just slip over into oppressive lies.
Yeah.
Temptation is an influence of the demonic. Mm-hmm. Did you know that?
Yeah.
But temptation isn't sin. Did you know that? How many of you knew that?
Yeah.
Temptation isn't sin. Because Jesus was tempted and he didn't sin. Praise God.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
You run around saying temptation is sin. It's not. Otherwise, Jesus sinned. He was tempted in all ways the words tempted. And was without sin. Okay? But then something happens and it goes a little bit deeper. And people start having things going on in their thought life. They got things going that is taking them into a place of actions, activities, deeds. That becomes oppressive. That becomes influence of the enemy. Offense, hurt, bitterness, huh? Rejection. How many of you know that rejection is not a fruit of the Spirit or activity of God the Holy Ghost? Why not resist it steadfast in the faith then? Why give it? Why yield to it? We're supposed to be over here in the school of the Spirit. You receive so that you may now know how to yield yourself in a deeper dimension to the teacher. That's why it was given. It wasn't given as the Pentecostal expression. His Holy Spirit was poured out upon all flesh. Somebody said, is everybody supposed to have the gift of tongues? Yeah, you are. Absolutely. Well, why did Paul say in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, do all speak with tongues? Because some aren't saved yet. Some of you don't even know yet. Huh? Some still have they're making a decision. I'll give you an answer for every one of those rhetorical questions. Would you like me to? Because the other school is totally wrong. They're speaking from a complete realm of silence.
Yes. Yep.
It is amazing to me how many people know things that God never said anything about. Let me say it again. It is amazing to me how many people know things God never said anything about. Come on, let's just know what he said.
That's right, amen.
He poured out his Spirit upon all flesh in the context of the Holy Ghost being poured out, and they all begin to speak with other tongues, the gift of the Holy Ghost. Peter said, this is that which Joel the prophet spoke of that would come to pass in the last days, saith the Lord. I'll pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. When somebody gets the Holy Ghost poured out upon them, that's what it looks like, Acts 2:4.
Yeah.
And how many get that? Everybody. And does that help you with your rhetorical question in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 20? Hallelujah. Get rid of the doubt and the unbelief. Start obeying God's word. You got to get childlike, simple faith. You open up the Bible, you read it, and you go, I want that.
Right.
I'll do that. Please, God, I can't live without what you want for me. We're looking for a glorious church to start functioning in the authority and the power of Jesus Christ. I'm tired of the profaning of his name because people sitting around on their hands in religion. Are you listening to me? Let's get rid of religionity. Hallelujah. Come on. Tikashala makaya papataya. Either get in or get out. Do something. That's how Joshua preached. Decide who you gonna serve today. Get in or get out. Get hungry. Get real. Quit being a poser. Quit acting like what you got's the goods. What God's got's the goods. Here's the fruits of what He said. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Abrovoda. I'm gonna give myself to faith. I'm not on belief and doubt. I'm gonna give myself to purity. I got a river of it. I got a river of divine power. I got a river of divine ability. Just because I don't tap in to it and don't allow it to function, doesn't make it any difference at all. But as I begin to tap into that river and I allow that river of plenty, that river of provision, that river of His power, that unlimited ability that God gives, as I give myself to it, then it begins to be expressed with a greater effulgency, a greater flow, a greater display. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And you've got to start learning it at your age, JJ.
Yes.
Huh?
Amen.
And I know that my biggest shouting fan, Judah, has fallen asleep in the meeting. Because he come under the peace of the, he's in some deep peace right now, you know. But he's a little guy, but he's got to learn. He's got to learn it. It's a great posture for sitting up sleeping. I'm going to tell you right now, sleeping will not stop what I'm saying, though. It won't stop. It's going in his little spirit. He's here. Praise God for daddy. Mama, get him in church. Get him in school of the spirit. I'm just so thankful that you're here in the school of the spirit tonight. You're hungry. There's a lot of people that, and they're going to go, they're not going to go to school of spirit on Friday night. Friday night is like my night. That's the problem. Here's what the Lord's doing. You give yourself to these things, and you're not going to have a sin problem. You give yourself to these things, you're going to have a, you're not going to have, you're, if you're passionate about these things, you're not going to have a disobedience problem. You get clothed with humility. That's what God the Holy Ghost is teaching us how to do. You get clothed with humility and walk in love. It is a defense against everything that Satan would try to secretly put on you. He can't get to you. Clothed with humility, you're walking in love. There's no way. He cannot secretly, covertly influence you. He can't deceive you. You can't get deceived. You can't. Because that's living and abiding in the glory of the Holy Ghost, and the Spirit of truth has come to lead us and guide us into all truth. And when we're doing what He's doing, when we give ourselves to what it is He's doing, we got it. I'm not going to sit around and watch people take 20 years to get this one verse of Scripture. I'm telling you, I'm going to get radical again. I'm going to start hollering at the naked people again. I'm telling you. When I worked at this one place in science, everybody had their little sketchy sports swimwear and all this other stuff, calendars. I made clothing. I made various different dresses. I made formal wear, you know. Everything at least came to the knees, and I went and I taped them. I gave everybody dresses. And when they took it off, guess what? The Holy Ghost man came back out at night and I gave him new dresses. And as many times as they took it off, as many times as I put it on. And I promise you, it got to the place where nobody took it off. And they knew who did it. Come on, people, let's get radical. Let's not sit evil things in front of us. Let us come into the church and lift our hands and praise God and go and participate with demon spirits by watching stuff on the television that the Lord said, destroy them, that you may crush evil out of your midst.
Amen.
And though there is grace and mercy, we don't do that now. We're supposed to do it for our own lives. Yet there is no question about it. Father feels exactly the same way, and it's judgment postponed. That's all it is. And the more you give yourself to sin, the harder your heart gets. the more you justify it, the more deceived you become, the more arrogant you become, the more disrespectful you become, the more argumentative you become, the bigger strife maker you become. I'll go down the list. Because everything of the work of the flesh begins to be manifested out of that demonic stronghold. Because it's backslidden. Somebody said, oh, we need a Christian deliverance. No such thing as Christian deliverance. You're not a born-again, demon-possessed person. You backslidden, man. You know, you like just like the sons of God that followed Satan. You with me?
Yeah.
Exactly. But you can be redeemed, praise God. He can be forgiven. You backslidden. You just need to be saved. You need to be born again. You need to get right with God. People don't like that. Oh, you mean we're being born again? Our name's being, God's got a big eraser. And our name's being written in and raced out and written back in and raced out. Isn't it going to make a hole? No, it isn't. And it doesn't need, an eraser. It's this crazy, illogical thinking of men. I'm prove it to you. Sin produces death. I'm going to prove it to you. Just go ahead and prove it to you. Since everybody knows so much things, all the things that God never said anything about, let me go ahead and tell you what he did say something about. Yeah. Look right here in James, just back up, and then I'm going to finish here. I'm gone longer than I wanted to, but I'm a bit provoked because I heard somebody in the place was sinning. Heard somebody was in the place was sinning in the parking lot. I'd smack you. Man, if I find you, I'll be a Phineas. I'll beat the snot out of you. I promise you, I'll beat the snot out of you. I promise you. You believe it. So you can say, I'm not going to go to the church over there, man. He'll beat the snot out of you. It's fine. I'm going to beat the snot out of you. I'll beat the hell out of you. I pray I beat the hell out of you. Amen. Amen. Through the laying on of hands, you get a heavenly anointing and a fear of God. Amen.
Amen.
I told you, I'm just going to get radical again.
That's right. Amen.
Not being as radical enough hasn't been working. I'm going to be radical again.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Habakata sete yafra. You listening to me?
Yes.
Man, you've got sin in your life. You don't even have the right to pick up a piece of trash on the floor in the house of God. You hear me?
Yeah.
You don't have the right to pick up a piece of trash.
Yeah.
Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
Get right with God and stay right with God. God has given you everything you need.
Amen.
We've got to get to the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of holiness. Come on, people.
Yeah.
It's just God's going to raise up some radical people that aren't going to tolerate it anymore.
Yeah. That's right.
God's going to raise up some radical people that aren't going to tolerate it. God is going to make a distinction between the holy and the profane. Those who are His and those who are not His. He's going to make a distinction. It's going to happen. All these false doctrines, all these lying doctrines that cannot be proven, they're not proven in the Word. God is very clear. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He feels exactly about sin as He right now as He did in Numbers and Deuteronomy. Didn't change one bit. He feels exactly the way He did when He spoke to Isaiah. Exactly the way He did when He spoke to Elijah. Exactly the way He did when He spoke through Enoch. Here we, I'm going to just read this to you. Let no man, verse 13, let no man say when he's tempted. It's James chapter 1, verse 13. James chapter 1, verse 13. Let no man say when he's tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempts He any man. But every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own desires and enticed. And when that desire has conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it is done, it brings forth death. And that's what God said. The wages of sin is death. It's spiritual death. It's stinking spiritual suicide.
That's right.
I pray in the name of Jesus that you'll come and begin to participate with us, something that the church needs to be longing for and crying out for, Holy Ghost conviction. Yeah. Holy Ghost conviction is living in an awesome awareness of the presence of God. And that ain't going to happen until God's people start living together collectively in awesome awareness of the presence of God. And you're living in awesome awareness of the presence of God, your Bible's not going to be gathering dust on a shelf somewhere.
That's right.
You listen to me. You're living in awesome awareness of the presence of God, you're not going to have to try to find time to pray.
Amen.
Give me a break. And I'm telling you, you give yourself over to the school of the Spirit. You let Him begin to interact with you like this because you're hungry for His realms. I'm telling you, He's going to fill you with compassion and vision and insight. He's going to give you divine appointments. He's going to give you words of knowledge. He's going to give you the ability to speak a word to a person's heart and unlock the door of the prison that they've been living in. He's going to cause you to be moving and get to faith where you're going to lay hands on the sick and they're going to recover and the limbs are going to grow out and the blind eyes are going to open and the dead are going to raise to life That's again right. and the people yes. are going to hear your words and they're going to begin to tremble and shake under the power of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
People, this is what we've got to contend for. This is the faith that was once delivered unto the saints. This is a fight. If you're not in a fight, you're never going to have a victory. I believe Wiggles were said, if you don't know how to engage in the good fight of faith, you're never going to understand faith. You never entered into the conflict, you're never going to understand the overcoming power. This is just true. I love listening to the men of God who stepped into the glory of God, the purity of God, the nature of God, and displayed not only his nature, but also His power, who are just doing nothing but speaking the Word of God and the examples to us. And it's time that you let God raise you up to be an example too. Amen. I'm going to tell you right now, I want to see my sons and my daughters raised up to be an example Amen. Of what it right. means to be citizens of heaven, That's to live right. out the very life yes. of Jesus yes. Christ, Amen. To walk in the Holy Ghost. There's going to have Amen. To be a distinction. There's going to have to be someone who yes. makes a difference. There's going to have to be a light that shines. I'm not interested in people in this church anymore running any interference. I told the Lord, I said, Lord, from now on, when I detect it, because I can detect it, I have a detector, a Holy Ghost discerning detector. Now I'm just going to sort it out. I'm going to sort it out. I'm going to say, quit thinking what you're thinking right now and behaving as you're behaving.
Yeah.
Because I'm telling you right now, when people have got sin of any kind in their life, it grieves the Holy Ghost, and when He's grieved, I'm grieved. It outrages Him, and I'm outraged when He's outraged. Yes. Amen. He's like saying, what are they doing in here? They're blemishes. They're spots in your feast of perfection. They're leaven in the midst of this unleavened bread that I've made. Yes. That's what the Holy Ghost says. He doesn't want it. He wants it dealt with. He wants you to repent. When I'm talking about the body of Christ, I'm not talking about the lost to come in. I'm talking about the body of Christ. Huh? The church of the Lord Jesus Christ, the people who are supposed to know. Because when the body of Christ are connected by the Holy Ghost, see, every time we walk into church, we're supposed to be baptized into the very being of Jesus Christ by the Holy Ghost. For you all baptized in one body by the Holy Ghost. Every time you walk into the church, you're supposed to yield yourself to the Holy Ghost to come into a special union with everybody in the place. Yes. When that is going on and somebody walks in who doesn't know the Lord, they are going to become under such Holy Ghost conviction. They are going to be convinced of all, reproved of all, and the thoughts and the intent of the heart are going to be made manifest and falling down. They're going to say, God is in this place.
Amen.
I'm telling you right now, I can feel the zeal of the Lord for it. I can feel His provoked anger over it, where He's got a whip in His hand to drive out the money changers. I'm not kidding you. I'm not just saying this. I'm telling you. I want you to come into the school of the Spirit and start straighten up, act right.
Amen.
Get yourself under submission. Start walking in lowliness of mind. Quit living with your feelings on your sleeve. Just because you've been beat up all your life, don't bring that form of conversation into this place. Be accepted and beloved and settle down and relax.
Amen.
You got to prove nothing. Amen.
That's right. Amen.
It's already been proven. Praise God.
Amen.
God wants to prove you. And let me just run over this real quick. And to your purity, knowledge. What is that? It's the knowledge of God. Bringing into captivity every thought to the knowledge, to the obedience of the Lord Jesus Christ. Casting down imaginations. Huh?
Yep.
Bringing every thought into captivity. Right? Why? Because we want to grab a hold of the knowledge of God. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. That's this knowledge you're talking about. When God gave us His Holy Spirit, He gave us, listen to what He did. He gave us seven dimensions of His Spirit. The life, as it were, the life force of His Spirit. Listen to this. He gave to us wisdom, His wisdom. He gave to us His understanding. Listen to me. Listen to me. Listen to me. Because too little, I don't think people don't even know this. Because it's there. This is what He gave us. He gave to us. He gave to us His wisdom. He gave to us His understanding. He gave to us His counsel. He gave to us His might. He gave to us His knowledge. And He gave to us His fear of the Lord. Well, if you don't even know, people don't even know how to enumerate or quote the sevenfold anointing of the Spirit of God that was revealed by Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 11, then how are you ever going to recognize that that's yours? And that you can now have confidence to move in it. Because you don't even, it's not even precious enough to you to even know what it is. Well, that's silly, isn't it? You couldn't be more stupid and still be breathing. Are you with me, right? To say that this is, you're so passionate about this and you love God so much and these things are so important to you and you don't even know what the nine fruits of the Spirit is, are in Galatians chapter 5. Give me a break. Yes. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Oh, this is so precious and so valuable to me. You don't even know what the seven dimensions of the Holy Ghost is? You know, come on.
Yeah.
Get in the school of the Spirit.
Yeah.
You wouldn't be past first grade if that was the case. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
If that is the case, I pray that that's not a case, the case of anybody in here. I hope I'm just talking to somebody on the web right now. I would go around right now with the microphone, just kind of give a real spot test. But I'm gonna give you a break. I'm going to give you time to get ready for the next School of the Spirit. Hallelujah. He embarrassed me. Well, you know what? You'd rather me embarrass you than you be embarrassed before the throne of grace. Find out you're not right with God and it's too late. Hello. I got a message from some folks that moved out of town into Tennessee and they go, well, we're in another church. We think it's Assemblies of God, but nobody's sorting us out like you do. Bless their hearts. They quit coming to church because I sorted them out. But then now they're longing for it. Hallelujah. Don't you tell me that some demon spirit is more beautiful to you and more lovely to you than God the Holy Ghost. Come on, girls. Hey. Don't you tell me some demon spirit is more lovely to you and more beautiful to you than Jesus. Because when you yield yourself to Him and partake of His sin, that's exactly what you're saying.
That's right.
Come on, people. Come on. Those of you who know and are matured enough, it's time for you to rise up.
Yes.
Get out of the stuff that you're in. Get out of your downcast looks. Get out of your poor opinions of yourself. Get yourself some great self-confidence in Christ Jesus. Come on, man. Hallelujah. Start living in boldness and confidence. Start doing exploits in God. Hallelujah. Praise God. For me, the biggest evidence of that you've been born again is that you know how to deal properly with every devil and you cease from sin. That's God's word. That's what God says. Because the greater one lives on the inside of you and you've come to know it. Come on, girls, you just don't let him play you. Come on. You disrupted me. Or interrupted me or something. Quiet. Turn her around. Spank her. Pinch her something. Because she's playing patty cake. She's playing you. I'm telling you. I know the drill. I know the look. That was a great picture Ali posted of Naomi fall asleep while I'm preaching them. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Well, she's going to be the next. She's in her generation, she's got to take up the torch. She needs to learn now. She's got to be passionate about the things of God. Jesus, help us. I'm glad He is. To knowledge, temperance. To temperance, patience. To patience, godliness. Hallelujah. Temperate in all things. Hallelujah. Patient in all things. Godliness. Come on, man.
Amen.
Brotherly kindness. divine love. You know, when you think about these things, this is a school of spirit. When you think about love, listen, just think about this. Keeping ourselves in love. He that dwells in love dwells in God. Come on. Could there be any more plain indicator of where we're at any given moment? You know what I'm saying? It's going to shut down every behavior and action that's not the love of God as is defined in Christ Jesus that lays down his life for us. Come on. And we just got to pay attention. This is the school of the Spirit. No interrupting. I mean, if you just took one, I'd like to say this. You got to get past love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness. But just think about this one, goodness. That you could live all day long in goodness? Oh, and you're not going to? You've been given all power of heaven to live all day in goodness, and you're opting out? You are, come on. No, that is just simply neglect. It's brain damage. Yeah. It's inability to even think properly. You with me?
Yes.
It's like total short-term ministry, you know.
Yeah. Come on.
Dysfunction on a level that on a grandiose level.
Yeah.
That's like forgetting to breathe. It's so good. But it doesn't become forgetting to breathe until you live in it, because it's so good, then you can't live without it. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Raise your hand if you can't hear me. You know what the Lord said? He said, I'm going to cause all my goodness to pass before you, Moses.
Yes.
I'm going to cause all my goodness. And he said, you can live in that all day long.
Amen.
A river full.
Amen.
Rivers full. Not a cup full, not a glass full. Not a 10,000, gallon tank full. Rivers full. He said, I want you to give all diligence. So here's the school of the Spirit. Come into the school of the Spirit. Be led by the Holy Ghost. Be taught by God. Quit misbehaving. Come on. Quit doing your own stuff. Quit living your own life. Quit getting all wrapped up and entangled with thorns that's choking you to death. People walking around, God's people walk around like this. Choking themselves, man. With the decisions that they're making. I mean, how can I impress this upon you tonight?
Amen.
If there's anybody in this place tonight, you got torment and affliction going on in your life. Number one. Number two, you are still got sin going on in your life. See, we want to spend time with you. I've got a prayer team. Jenny's got a prayer team. We spend time with you. We'll pray you through. We'll help you understand how to shut the doors on that power of darkness so demonic powers cannot enter your life anymore.
Yeah.
If you've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost, to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost is to receive the expression of the language of heaven.
Amen.
And I'm going to tell you right now, I'm about to the point where I'm going to start having some time where I go spend time with people in prayer. Just take you off, go pray in a room. And if you start speaking in tongues, and I feel like somebody's, running their fingernails across the chalkboard, we're going to help you. Because there's too many times I've heard that kind of utterances. We're going to get you, we're going to help you. We're going to get right in the big midst of your life. And if we see some open wound, we're going to stick our hand up in there and we're going to pull all the dirt and all the junk out of it. Amen. I know it's going to be painful. It's going to hurt. You're going to holler a bit, but just hang still and just let us know if you need us to tie you up while we do it. We'll give you an epidural while we do it. And we'll pour in the healing ointment. Get rid of that stuff. God gives you a lifetime to get right. Why take a lifetime?
Amen.
When it can happen in a moment, an instant, twinkling of an eye. Why being, it's like so many people, they're not repented yet. They're not repented yet. Because this is not a religion. This is a relationship that you're born into. And when you repent, you're born again and you receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. You hear me?
Yes.
I don't care what your doctrinal belief is. I'm talking to you what the Bible says.
Yep.
Declaring to you what the Word of God says.
Amen.
And you ought to be hungry and thirsty enough to want what God says rather than to be, you know, content to whatever, to have whatever it is you believe. Because then that makes you no different than the rest of the world. Makes you no different. The goodness of God leads us to repentance. Many people are just sitting on, they have not repented. They're looking. They're coming to the meetings, but they're not repented. They're not right with God yet. They're still going back into their stuff. Alcohol is a demon power. A sip of it is a demon power. A sip. A little teeny, teeny tiny, mini micro shot glass sip. A communion cup sip. Where you got to fight capillary action to get it out of there. I don't know, and I just went. I wanted to give you the rundown because these people got compromises come going on in their life, right, left, and center. And they, oh well, yeah, alcohol's a terrible thing, but I only drink a little vodka. No, I can get it. I understand how this thing works. Yeah. Self-justify. I'll give you self-justification. Give you brain damage. See, when you get born again, all sin has an intense Holy Ghost conviction. Now, if you override Holy Ghost conviction, you become numb to it, and now you're not convicted in it anymore. Your heart becomes hardened. Then you become self-justified in the thing, and you can't move on with God. And we got too many people throughout this nation in that condition, throughout Europe, Western world in that condition. Yes. Now, the only way that we're going to make any difference is you're going to start living it right.
Yeah.
It's the only way we're going to make a difference. Because we're going to give ourselves, look, you know, we're going to give ourselves to the purity of God and to the power of God. Because that's what the gift of the Holy Ghost is all about all at once. You know, the Lord didn't say build up. And people say, oh, don't start with raising the dead. Start with headaches. You know, did you read that in the Bible? Go into all the world and preach. Start with headaches. Go and preach the gospel of the kingdom. Don't start with the dead. Don't start Jesus. Here's Jesus saying, now guys, I know you've been watching me. You don't really get it yet. You know, your heart's still hard. And you don't really, you can't understand. You don't get it. But listen, what we're going to do is we're going to build up to raising the dead. And we're going to build up to the blind eyes and deaf ears and the cripple and the diseased. And what I want you to do is I want you to go out there and find everybody's got a toe problem. Minor pains. You guys go through the towns and villages announcing, we're ministering to minor pains because we're learning how to build up into flowing and greater gifts. He told them, go right, first thing, right off the bat. Soon as you get saved, soon as you get into power, when I go raise the dead. Oh, we don't want them to be discouraged. Who cares what you want, man? You don't even have a verse of scripture in the Bible. Back off, buddy. The Lord said, you can't, he's not going to receive any offering from an altar that's had man's tools put on it. You hear me? I don't want no man to get your tools away from me. Hallelujah. I don't want to be shaped by you. I don't want your ideas and your philosophies and your opinions. Hallelujah. I've been born again full of the Holy Ghost. I'm doing it God's way by his word. He's made me his altar and a sacrifice too. Now it's up to you. I don't feel like I should point people out, but I know everybody in this place that needs them to be in the deliverance chair. I know everybody in this place that needs to be in the deliverance chair. You have to decide for yourself where you need to be in deliverance. I don't need to be in no deliverance chair. Hallelujah. God tell you, I live free from all that mess. I'm living in the realms of divine glory. I got everything he said I was supposed to have and the expressions of his fruits in and of his gifts. Hallelujah. I've got a witness that I've been born of the Spirit. And you need to have one too. What was the witness that they were born of the Spirit that Paul talked about in Romans chapter 8? You saw it in Galatians chapter 10. You better get it. Hallelujah. If you've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost, you should desperately want to be. And all you got to do is Just come let us know. Because we're not going to force you to. We're not going to get you to stand up and try to talk you into anything. Because if you're not hungry for it, you can't have it anyways.
Yes.
If we got to talk you into it, ain't nothing going to happen.
That's right.
You got to be desperate for these things.
Yeah.
Feel obligated. Feel obligated to breathe. Feel obligated to have joy. Feel obligated to be free. No.
Come on.
But I tell you, I believe this with all of my heart right now. The Spirit of the Lord is here to give you wisdom and revelation to cause you to know things that you have not understood. That you're going to begin to, some of you are going to begin to call upon God like you've never called upon Him before. And He's going to show you great and mighty things that you've not known.
Amen.
Father will show every person in this place how to live in divine health, but you're going to have a battle before you do it. You can step over into divine wealth, but you're going to have to fight health before it happens. You can step over into divine displays of the gifts of the Spirit, but you're going to have to deal with every imp of darkness that wants to try to slander you, ridicule you, and say you can't do it. You got to stand there and prophesy.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. And Father just gives us, just floods our souls with all this divine power and ability. And nothing's in the way. Nothing's in the way. Nothing stands in the way of the new birth. When you call upon the name in an honest and sincere heart, you don't have to fight for it. Nothing stands in the way. Nothing stands in the way of the gift of the Holy Ghost. He just pours it out upon us as long as your heart's right. And you don't, nobody earns it. He just gives it to us. Now, to flow, to mature, to grow, to develop in it, now you're in the battle. But you're resourced. We fight this battle from the high ground of victory. But it's nonetheless a fight. And it's nonetheless a battle. But we fully resourced. But we have to do what? Give all attendance. I didn't read the rest of this. But give all attendance to making our calling and election certain. Because if we do these things, we will never stumble. We won't even stumble. How about that, everything? And an entrance shall be ministered to us abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And he's talking about a means of flowing in the power and authority and operating in the Holy Ghost. He's not talking about translation and translating in the kingdom of dear son, because that happens at the new birth, Colossians 1:13. Colossians 1:13 is significantly different from 2 Peter chapter 1:11. Understand that. It's significantly different. It's talking about two different things. When you begin to give all attendance to these things, you're not going to be carried away with sin and iniquity. You're not. Amen. Satan doesn't have a chance. Because you're living in the glory. He doesn't have a chance. You're kept by the power of God.
Yes.
This is the way it is. We know that everyone who is born of God does not sin. He keeps himself, and the wicked one cannot access him. You know, it's terrible that most people are intimidated to even quote that verse of Scripture. In fact, and even more than most, don't even know where that verse of Scripture is. They that are born of God do not sin, for his seed remaineth in them, and they cannot sin. People are intimidated to quote that verse of Scripture. They're intimidated to quote that verse of Scripture. They got to go get counseling for 2 years after hearing it. And to me, it's life. It's power. And even more people don't even know where the verse of Scripture is. They're intimidated by it. They're threatened by it. I'm liberated by it.
Amen.
Why aren't we liberated by it? Why aren't we liberated by it? Tell me, why aren't we liberated by it? Why is 1 John 3, 3:8 acceptable, but 1 John 3:7 and 1 John 3:9 are not acceptable? 1 John 3:7 says, we know that everyone who does righteousness is righteous even as his righteous. I guess I said that verse 8 was acceptable. Actually, I have to recant. Verse 8 can't be acceptable. And he that sins is of the devil. And we know that he was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. And everyone who is born of God does not sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin. And I could go on quoting the rest of the entire epistle for you if you would like. But now we would just be getting into fascinating you. But you should learn how to quote it because it'll change you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Right.
Now who are you and whose side you on and how born again are you? Ha, bando saite. I'm telling you right now, I'm going to be kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed. Amen. Are you?
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm going to be kept by the power of God because I'm going to keep myself.
Yeah.
Father gave me authority. Father gave you ability to tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy so that nothing could by any means hurt you.
True.
That means no sin can touch you.
Yeah.
That means no devil can make you do anything. Praise God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Sabakatara. Amen. So some people got to clean their house.
Yeah.
You need to get the stuff out of it. If it's something that is going to lead you into ungodliness, something that's going to lead you and cause you into sin or iniquity, get it out of your house. Amen. Get into the school of the Spirit. Get real with God. Amen. Amen.